Hello and welcome back to Fails and Flails, everybody. And then if this is your first time, welcome. And also don't forget to subscribe so you can see all the future videos that come out. But without further ado, in this video, we're going to be talking about playing more realistic monsters for your next TTRPG game. So let's get rolling. Despite a lot of monsters having fairly high intelligence scores, many game masters tend to not play them that way. I've covered this specific area that I'm going to cover next in a previous video about running better encounters, but I'm just going to reiterate for the sake of this video. Monsters should be going into combat with some sort of tactics in mind. This isn't the 1700s where each side lines up across each other in a wide open field and just, attacks each other until one side falls. Every single monster is going to have their own specific tactics. Many of them are going to be guerrilla warfare kind. And they're going to take advantage of these tactics in order to basically have an advantage over their opponent, your players. A lot of people will look at a monster's stat block and see a super low intelligence and think, oh, that means it just kind of runs towards the enemy and is totally fine with just getting completely cut up and murdered by a group of players or adventurers that it honestly has no chance against. Let's take a look at the gelatinous cube, for instance, in D&D 5e. It has an intelligence score of 1, which is as low as it can get. However, a gelatinous cube is still a hunter. While it may not be book smart or know anything about the arcane, it still knows how to hunt, and that's how it's going to see adventurers who are strolling through a dungeon is as potential prey. So probably the best thing that a gelatinous cube has going for it is that it's basically invisible unless it has anything inside of it. So it can very easily, wait up top on a, hallway or whatever it is, and just drop down on the adventurers. Or it can just be in the middle of the hallway and can allow them to walk right into it because it is technically invisible if it's not moving. In D&D, wolves have an intelligence of 3, which you'd consider to be also extremely low. However, they have, and like in real life and in the game, they would use their pack tactics. Now, in the game, they literally have the ability pack tactics, which give them advantage against an opponent if they have an adjacent ally. But I'm saying that they wouldn't just go sprinting off at the enemy or, again, the adventurers. They would take their time to stalk them and slowly encircle them until they have them all surrounded and surprise them all at once when they make their attack. Even goblinoids and orcs, which many consider to be fairly stupid, would use tactics such as setting up an ambush or using a pincer attack to attack from the front and then have a smaller group go around from behind and attack the weak wizard or the ranger who's not used to being into melee combat. Again, these are, dumb creatures if you're talking about like book smarts and whatnot, but they are smart when it comes to finding and killing their prey, and that is where their intelligence, however little bit of it is, that's where it comes through, and that's how you should use it when you're playing these monsters in your own game. Switching over to something with a little bit more intelligence, we're going to talk about green dragons, which are actually my favorite of the chromatic dragons. These are the most cunning and treacherous of all dragons, and if a group of adventurers wandered into a green dragon's lair, it wouldn't just attack immediately. It would welcome them in, kind of try to get them to lower their guard. If they're trying to, I don't know, come there to just slay it or rescue somebody, it's going to try to play that off. Maybe, be very welcoming and wholesome. Basically act the exact opposite of whatever other people told them. After they've dropped their guard, maybe then it's going to try to get them to do it again even further, or as soon as it sees an opportunity, that's when it's going to attack. Sea hags are easily the weakest of all the hags in D&D 5e, at least for now. However, a coven of sea hags can be a deadly force against even a group of high-level adventurers because they know how to use their abilities. They can use their false appearance to turn into a horrendous or ugly, but a somewhat normal appearance. If a group of adventurers coming after them, I mean, first off, the hags are going to try to make some sort of bargain or deal with them. Obviously, this deal is always going to be heavily favored in the hags, corner, but they're going to try to find what exactly the players want and see if they can feed off that. If combat breaks out, though, they're going to drop their false appearance and reveal their horrifying appearance, which makes all of the adventurers who can see them, which is probably all of them if they were just talking with them, make a wisdom saving throw against being frightened. And because there are three hags in that coven, that means every single player has to make three saving throws, and all it takes is one to become frightened. Next is where their death glare ability comes in, and this is where it gets kind of fun. because any frightened creature who can see the hag must make another wisdom saving throw or instantly drop to 0 hit points, similar to the banshee's howl or scream, whatever it is. And every single night hag can use this every single turn. It doesn't have a cooldown whatsoever. So as long as one of the players or adventurers stays frightened, they can continue to use this ability to instantly drop them to 0. All it takes is a single bad roll. They also, with their coven magic, can cast Eyebite, which would force another saving throw against being frightened, so they can, again, use their Death Glare ability. So as you can see, the monsters really know how to use their abilities and use them well. And if you play them well, you can definitely see that these encounters are going to be much more difficult for your players than they normally would be. Obviously, I'm not saying just kill your players outright with super overpowered monsters or anything, but you can take a normally balanced or slightly easier encounter for your players and make it into a more challenging one, which obviously is more fun, assuming they win. The last monster I'll cover for this specific part of the video is the Lich. Now, obviously, if your players are high enough level that they think they can take on a Lich, it may be hard to balance the encounter because they're probably pretty strong. But a Lich has one upper hand on them, and that is its immunity to poison, which combined with its ability to cast the spell Cloud Kill means it can cast this spell directly on itself, forcing any melee characters who want to get up close to it make those constitution saving throws or take 5d8 poison damage every single turn, I believe it is. And obviously the Lich can keep casting this spell, so all those melee characters who want to get up close and personal are probably going to continue to take more and more poison damage. The next topic that I'm going to cover is actually the complete opposite. This is when the monsters are losing, getting their butts absolutely handed to them, and the instance was when they should actually flee from combat. And this can actually happen at the very beginning of combat. Let's say that your players manage to, you know, set it up really well, and they sneak up on the opponents from, like, up on a high cliff, and all the enemies that they're facing don't have any ranged weapons, or maybe a couple of them do, but they're maybe a sling, or one of them has a crossbow, and that's about it. And your players start just pelting on them with ranged spells, arrows, javelins, and all that stuff, and the enemy has no way to fight back. They're not going to sit there and just take it. They may, well, probably the first thing is that they're going to take cover, but once they realize that they have no chance of winning this battle, they're very likely going to flee. Also, if your players manage to sneak up on them and surprise them, if they're going against goblins or something, maybe those who are a little bit less courageous, it's very likely that a couple of those goblins, obviously not like all of them, but at least one or two, may actually just flee from combat entirely, leaving his more than likely soon-to-be-dead allies behind. Once combat actually starts and your players are managing to gain the advantage on the enemies, this is where actual intelligence manages to kind of come into play. For those lesser intelligence creatures, such as like basically anything with like a 7 intelligence or lower, they're probably going to fight to the death. There's a pretty good chance because they're not thinking towards the future. A lot of creatures such as orcs or goblins, or, you know, hobgoblins, still goblins, their life is war and fighting, and so to die in battle may be what they're after, rather than, you know, living a long life. Whereas more intelligence creatures know that, you know, they may lose this battle, but they can learn from it, go on, and win the next one. Let's say your party is down in the Underdark, and they are battling a group of Duergar, and these Duergar are rallied around their captain, who they're willing to lay down their lives for and fight alongside. If that captain is killed, all of that motivation and support and courage is very likely going to completely diminish, and the remaining Duergar will probably flee because their captain is no longer alive, who they would lay down their lives for, but he's no longer dead, so they can't do that. So their next best option is to flee and regroup and maybe try to launch a counterattack with more numbers at a different time. In the same way, if your players are fighting a large group of enemies and your players manage to cut them down to half their original size, where they were originally 10 or 12 monsters, they are now 5 or 6. And the monsters would be usually smart enough, even for dumber monsters, to know that they don't have a chance. And at that point, they would, again, flee from combat because they don't have a chance. And finally, if, let's say, again, they're down in the Underdark and there's just a single Duergar who is, you know, on patrol or whatever, if he sees the group of adventurers, he knows he's at an overwhelming odds there. He's not going to try to, go and attack them. He's going to go and alert the rest of the Duergar that are in their camp, and so they can all go and together attack them where they much have better odds. With more intelligent creatures, though, they're going to flee basically as soon as they get dropped down to less than half their health, because at that point they know that they're maybe just a few good shots away from actually dying, and an intelligence creature isn't going to just accept that. They're okay with taking on a little bit of embarrassment for being defeated, rather than trying to blindly fight and just accept death if that's what happens. Because the intelligent creatures can learn, and they will. Especially, this is a good way to make a reoccurring villain, possibly. They've battled against your players once, they know their tactics now. And so the next time that they go up against them, they're going to remember those strategies and formulate some plan to basically shatter your players' normal strategies. This can create for a very interesting and, compelling battle for a future session. It may seem kind of anticlimactic if your players don't get to finish off all of the enemies, but that may just be for a murder hobo group. If your players want to understand that the world is realistic, or they want it to be realistic, that last goblin isn't going to stay and fight to the death. He's going to try to get the heck out of there, because there's no way he stands a chance against, several fifth level adventurers. So while it may, your players may not get enough XP, you can basically say that they still defeated that goblin or whatever it was because it fled away. So they did defeat it, they just didn't kill it. The last point that I'm going to make for this video is actually a mistake that I made a couple times myself when I was just a new DM. And this is, if you plan on giving your players a new magical item and they're going to find it after defeating this group of enemies, then those enemies should be using that magical item in combat. It doesn't make sense for, let's say, a bandit captain to be using just a regular sword when he has a +1 sword in his inventory, which is obviously there because the players are going to find it. These things don't just magically manifest after all the enemies are killed. So he should be using that +1 sword to, obviously, it's going to make him stronger, and obviously, it just makes sense. He would. It's a better item. If, let's say, you want to give your players a wand of fireball, then have whatever enemy that they're fighting be using that wand of fireball. Yes, it's going to make combat more difficult, or maybe throw a wrench in the cogs, whatever it is, but it's going to be better, and it just makes things more realistic and makes more sense. It's also going to be more rewarding for your players, because after the battle, it's not going to be that they just find a wand of fireball, which obviously, anybody would be excited about, but during battle, they see the enemy caster using a wand of fireball, and they're like, oh, awesome, if we beat that enemy, we get that wand. So it's, again, much more rewarding for your player. So keep that in mind next time you plan on dishing out some magical items or particularly good loot to your players. That's all I've got for this video. I hope you all enjoyed it. If you have any experiences of your own for running more realistic monsters, or maybe some times when the monsters were basically just played as brainless zombies, let me know down in the comment section. Don't forget to hit like and subscribe. It really helps the channel. Thank you for watching. So you all have an amazing day.